It starts from the crib, and it goes to the cross, and winds up with the crown. He started in the crib, praise God, on the physical side. And then he went to the cross, and praise God, he's going to wind up with a crown. They ain't crowned him yet, but he's going to be crowned, amen. Praise the Lord, amen. But there's 12 verses, and we'll just use the first one for our text. All right, if you're able to stand again, praise the Lord, we'll read one verse. But we'll be going through looking at these 12 verses briefly. Not all in the detail, but highlight through chapter 53 from the crib to the cross to the crown. Amen. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? You're going to see some things here not wonderful. King James Bible is a wonderful book. Amen. Find things and see some things that he says and what he does, it makes God more miraculous in your Christian life in Jesus Christ too, amen, to that thought, amen. So we're going to look tonight from the crib to the cross and to the crown. Pray for help and blessing tonight. Father, we thank you tonight for this privilege we have to be back on Wednesday night service. We get fueled up from the Word of God. Give us strength, Father, Lord, to face the enemy and what's out there in that old world, Lord. Father, we know it looks bad. God, when it looks bad, we know we can look at you and not be sad, Lord, because we know you can bring us through anything. Lord, if we pray and seek your face, Father, you're able to take care of things that are happening even today, Lord, and we just put it in your hands, Father. Not going to worry about it. Worry don't change anything, Father, Lord, because you tell us that in your precious word, Heavenly Father, Lord, to be anxious for nothing, Lord, and we're not to worry, Father, Lord. So we put it in your hands. Help us tonight and strengthen us through your word, and we'll love you and praise you, Father. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Amen. God be seated tonight. Appreciate you standing tonight. From the crib to the cross to the crown. Now in Isaiah 53, this chapter describes the whole work of Christ from the crib to the cross and to the crown. And we broke it down in different divisions, in four divisions for 12 verses here. So here's the first division that I see found in verses 1 down to verses number 3. We see the sorrowing Savior. The sorrowing Savior. First of all, he says, who hath believed our report? Now I see here in these scriptures about four things here in this first division about the sorrowing Savior. We see, number one, unbelief. Unbelief, because he said, who hath believed our report? And then he said this also in that verse 1 of Isaiah 53, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Now, let's see some things about our great God that we serve. Number one, he created the universe. He created the universe. In fact, the Bible says he used his fingers. He used his fingers. In Psalms chapter 8 and verse number 3, it says, when I consider thy heavens, the work, watch this now, of thy fingers. The work of thy fingers. So we find he creates the universe and his fingers are mentioned. Now watch this. Then the second thing that we see is he delivered Israel. Now, when he created the universe, he used his fingers. When he delivered Israel, he used his hand. He said in Exodus chapter number 13 and verse number 3, for by strength of hand, the Lord brought you out from this place. He creates the universe, uses his fingers. He delivers Israel from bondage, he used his hand. But when it comes to saving a sinner, he used his arm. Amen? He uses his arm. God used his arm. It took more to redeem a sinner than to create a world. Do you see how important we are to God? Amen. He used his arm on us. He made the world just use his fingers. Amen? Amen. Praise God, we are important and precious in the eyes of God. That's why the devil hates us.
He used his arm to redeem us.
Amen.
Amen. The psalmist said in Psalm 77:15, thou hast with thy arm redeemed thy people. Amen. Spit in the devil's eye with that one, will you? Amen. So he creates the universe, he uses fingers. He delivered Israel, he uses hand, but we redeem man, he uses arm. Amen. Praise God. What a God. The sorrowing Savior. We see the unbelief. And then there's the unproduced. In verse 2. The unproduced. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant. As a tender plant. And he also goes on that verse. He talks about a root out of dry ground. A root out of dry ground. And he's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ here. Now, Israel was a desert. There's a desert there. Amen. Yeah. Israel. I've seen some of it when I was over. It was impossible in the eyes of man to do what God is describing here from Israel's viewpoint. Jesus was a miracle. He was a miracle. Like finding a head of lettuce in the desert. You wouldn't find that. But the world could never have produced the Lord Jesus Christ. The world could not produce him. Evolutionists have tried to get rid of him because it didn't produce him. And it can't produce him. Amen. Praise the Lord. But we see it was through God. Now we see the unbelieved. We see the unproduced. But then there is the unattractive. The unattractive. Look down the latter part of verse 2. There's no beauty that we should desire him. We find the unattractive. Now here, this is talking about how he looked on the cross. Amen. No beauty that we should desire him. Back over in chapter 52 there in verse 14, you'll find that the scripture mentions, amen, that his vision was marred. His visage was so marred more than any man. So we see the unbelieved, the unproduced, and the unattractive when it comes to the sorrowing Savior. And then there's the unloved in verse number 3. We hid a lot of part of that verse, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. The unloved. Hey, they were not acquainted with him. And they had no admiration for him, but to us that are saved, he is altogether lovely. Amen.
Yeah, that's right.
He's the sweet rose of Sharon. He's the lily of the valley. Remember many years ago, Indian guy named Quentin Mills wrote a song, I found my lily in my valley. Thank God for the lily of the valley. So in verses 1 down to verses number 3, you see a sorrowing Savior. But when you get down to verses 4, down to verses number 6, not only do we see the sorrowing Savior, we see a smitten Savior. Go down to verses number 6. Notice something in verse number 6. What's the word that it starts with? All. What does it end with? All. It starts with all, and it ends with all. So what does that tell us? First of all, it tells us sin is universal. It is universal. All we like sheep have gone astray. It implies turning away, turning into another direction, and not coming back. So we find sin is a universal problem. But not only that, sin is an individual problem. It's an individual problem. We have turned everyone to his own way, the scripture says. Sheep do not stay together. Each one seeks his own selfish interests. What's going on in the world today? You got people seeking their own selfish interests, and they don't care about nobody else. They don't care about nobody else. Now listen. You got people, and you live in a country, and they let people come in, and they're telling everybody here that you got to watch it, you need to get your shot, you need to do this and that. But if you can come across the border and you ain't got to have one, we just turn you loose. Why would they do that? Because the only thing they care about is their own selfish interests, amen.
Right.
I pray God rock their boat, amen. I hope God rocks their boat. Amen. Will you watch rock it here, or we'll see him rock it at the judgment. He's going to rock it, amen. He's going to rock their boat. Amen. So we find sin is universal. Sin is individual, but then we see the sin bearer here that the scripture talks about. Latter part of verse 6. The Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Notice that word laid. That word laid means to rush against, to crash upon. To rush against, to crash upon. Like a large army troop upon a company. Like a large herd of bulls or a large pack of dogs. Talks about in Psalms 22, verse 12 and 13. He said, many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. Like a large angry wave pounding upon the rock of ages. Now, it's an important note right here that God's telling us something. He said, he laid on him. Notice what he said. He didn't lay it. He laid it on him. He didn't lay it in him. He didn't lay it in him. He laid it on him. During the Passover, the sins of Israel were placed on the head of the scapegoat, but never inside of him. Jesus bore our sins upon himself, but never in himself. Amen. So we see, first of all, the sorrowing Savior. Then in verses 4 through 6, we see the smitten Savior. And the third thing we see in verses 7 through 9, we see the silent Savior. There were several places in Scripture where he was silent. He was silent at the court. The Jews tried to shame him in every conceivable way, but he was always in control. Bible says a sheep, it talks about the sheep. And you know, a sheep is dumb. And he's suffering knowing that he was innocent. Now, he doesn't speak in certain places. He won't say anything. But even though he suffered, he knew he was innocent. And as a sheep is powerless and can do nothing about his suffering, but Christ suffered, restraining his power. See, when a sheep goes down, a sheep don't have the power to do nothing. Christ had to restrain his power to keep from doing anything. Think about that. He had to restrain his power. That's why he's God in the flesh. He could have, hey, listen. I know he could have called legions of angels, but if he wanted to, he didn't have to call no angels. He could have done it himself. Amen? So fine, he was silent at the cross. Notice something in verse number 8. He was, middle part of that verse, he was cut off out of the land, the Bible says. He was cut off. Cut off means he was wrenched. He died a terrible death. He did not die a martyr's death, for he did not support a lost cause. Now, compared to Stephen's death, Stephen was not forsaken because he seen the heavens open and Christ standing at the right hand of the Father. But a martyr was always comforted in his dying. When it comes to the Lord, he did not die an ordinary death. Because death in this verse in the plural means a thousand deaths. He was cut off. It's like dying a thousand deaths. And then he goes on to say this, who shall declare his generation? Who shall declare his generation? Down there in verses number 8. For 40 days, a town would, somebody would go and cry through the town of the city, before the death, crying about the statement which this person had made in his life. So there was supposed to be somebody before he died go through the city and be crying for this man. And guess what? They didn't do it. They didn't do it. They disregarded this. Same thing goes on today. There's a lot of stuff not supposed to be going on in this country. It's not constitutional. But it is. Same way this man, listen, you can look at Jesus and you can look at the day and hour we're living, you can see the same thing going on again. They disregarded what they were supposed to do for this man because it's all to them a setup. It wasn't no setup for God. We're going to see that in just a minute. It was no setup for God. So we find who shall declare his generation. He was silent at the cross. He was silent at the court. He was silent at the crypt. Look at verse number 9. He made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Now, a poor burial was a shame to a Jew. Read Ecclesiastes chapter 6 and verse number 3. And paraphrasing here about what Solomon mentions over there, he's mentioning if you live like 100 years and you were blessed to have 100 children, but if he didn't have a good burial, Solomon basically said it like this. If you lived to be 100 years old and God blessed you, you had 100 children, but you died and you had a poor burial, he said it'd be better if you'd not been born. Amen? That's found in Ecclesiastes 6, verse number 3. So they appointed, they assigned, and they relegated, and they intended to cast the highest possible things against Jesus Christ for him to die like a criminal. So he took the place of Barabbas, but to be buried like a criminal. That's the way that they were trying to work things out, for him to be buried like a criminal. They besought Pilate that the legs be broken, but like a criminal, they would break his legs. But we know the story. Jesus was already dead. But they wanted to treat him like a criminal. They wanted him to die like a criminal, and they wanted to bury him like a criminal. They denied him the privilege of an honorable burial and committed him to the same grave with the wicked, the Bible says. Criminals were thrown to the dogs back in those days. They were thrown to the dogs, or they put them in the potter's field, or they would take their bodies and put them in what? The garbage dump down in the valley of Hinnom, where the vultures and the jackals would devour their body, or they would use fire down in the valley of Hinnom to burn the body. But we find the scripture says in Psalms 22:20, deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. But then the scripture says this, he made his grave with the rich in his death. He was in control. God's always in control. They wanted to do it a certain way. God said, no, you ain't. He's going to be buried with the rich, amen. He's going to get a rich man's tomb, amen. Why? Because he owns it all anyway.
That's right. Amen.
That's right. See, what? You know what? Some of this mess is going on about driving me crazy, but you know what I figured out? God's working it the way he wants it to work.
Yeah, you're right.
Now, man's plotting. They're plotting on this side. And then you got some more. They're plotting on that side. But it'll be the way God wants it, because they ain't going to outdo God. They didn't outdo God. They wanted to bury him like a criminal. But God said, no, you ain't. No, you ain't. Because if it wasn't for him, all of you would go to hell. Amen? Praise the Lord. Y'all get anything out of this? That's what Mikey always said. Amen. His days. We see, first of all, he made his grave with the rich at his death. God was in control. Joseph of Arimathea took his body. Y'all know the story. Reading the gospel where Nicodemus was with him. They wound him in linen cloth. They embalmed him with myrrh and alloys. The Bible says about 100-pound weight. And they laid him in a new tomb of Joseph Arimathea. Now, how could Isaiah know all this? How did Isaiah know all this? Man deliberated, but God decided. Man deliberated it, but God decided how it would be. So man's doing a lot of deliberate even tonight. They probably have a meeting somewhere about America and what we can plan on doing. They can deliberate all they want to. God will decide.
Yep.
Amen. God will decide. Amen. So we've seen here, so far we've seen the sorrowing Savior. I'm about done. We've seen the smitten Savior. We've seen the silent Savior, but here's the fourth one on close. This is verses 10 through 12. The satisfied Savior. The satisfied Savior. First of all, we see his death was planned. Look at verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. God already planned it. He had put him to grief. Thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. He shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days. That's a mouthful right there. Let me see if I can explain some of that by the help and the grace of God. His death was planned. It was preordained from the foundation of the world. It was planned. All right? Now, the satisfied Savior, his death was planned. In fact, when Peter's preaching over in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 22 and 23, he's talking about how the death was determined beforehand. In fact, Peter said it like this. It was the foreknowledge of God. That's what he says. It was the foreknowledge of God. God knew exactly how it was going to happen when it happened. It was trespass offering. A trespass offering is to satisfy God, not the sinner. Satisfy God, not the sinner. His death was not a suicide, but a willing sacrifice. In his body was the possibility, but not the necessity of death. He is Lord of death as well as Lord of life. He dies not because he must. He dies not because of faintness. He dies not because of pain. He dies not because of the wounds. He died because he loved us. He loved us to death. Amen. He loved us to death. Praise God. Amen. His death was planned. His days were prolonged. Long life was a blessing regarded as a high favor among the Jews. If you had long days, you were blessed by God. It proved you were blessed by God. In Genesis 50:23, Joseph lived to hold his grandchildren on his knees, even to the grave. Jesus was resurrected to live forever. So if he was resurrected to live forever, guess what God did? He prolonged his days. You talk about your days being prolonging, you can't get better than forever. And ever, and ever, and ever. Amen. God hath prolonged his days. Amen. Jesus was raised to justify the scriptures. He was raised to justify the sinner, and Jesus was raised to judge the sinner. Amen. We see his days were prolonged. His descendants were seen. He shall see his seed. Look around this church tonight. Just the ones that we've got here. Just look around. This is his seed. He shall see his seed. He sees his church. Amen. He shall see his seed. To die childless was a grief and a shame to the Jews. But the Bible says he saw his children. Every born again child of God, he saw them. Now, what if they wrote that song? When he was hanging on the cross, I was on his mind. He done seen through the portals all the way down through eternity. He's seen all the children of God. He's seen his seed, and he was blessed, brother. Amen. Amen. He's got more children than anybody will ever have. Amen. Amen. His descendants were seen. His deeds were satisfied. Look in verse number 11. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. Now, travail means birth pain, like when a woman has a child. To deliver a baby. Hebrews 12 who says Jesus, for the joy that was set before him. Set before means this, to lie outstretched before your hand. He saw the whole race. He saw the whole history of the world in a glance, and he saw the glorified church. He saw the prize. He seen the outcome. He saw it all, and he went and got her done. He went to the cross, and he got her done. Amen. His deeds were satisfied. And his defeat of Satan was spectacular. He dies on the cross. Not to surrender,
but to defeat. What do you mean? That's the way he got her done. He died. He took the greatest enemy, or the greatest weapon that the devil had, and defeated him with his own weapon. He dies, but he does not die in defeat. Because, you know, a lot of people, well, he died on the cross and it's over. He's been defeated. But his hour of weakness was his hour of strength. His hour of weakness became his hour of strength. They lifted him up on a cross, and that cross became his throne. That's where he would defeat the enemy, was on the cross. When death seemed to conquer him, he was really using it that he might abolish it. The worst mistake the devil ever made, amen, thought, he's dead now, it's over. No, that's the worst mistake you ever made, buddy. He abolished death by dying. He abolished death by dying, amen. While the world looked on his hands and his feet that were nailed and fixed upon the cross, he's trampling upon hell, he's trampling upon death, he's setting up trophies of victory. He's scattering everlasting crowns and scepters, amen, to all the believers, amen. He's doing a work that the devil can't even comprehend, and he's doing it from the cross, amen. There's different names of saved people. I'm a child of God by birth. I'm a brother by adoption. I'm a sheep by purchase. I'm a citizen by victory. Satan was my king. He had me, amen, in chains, but Jesus led the army against Satan and he set me free. He divided the portion with the great. He divided the spoil with the strong. Look down at verse number 12. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great and shall divide the spoil with the strong. In closing, in ancient times, the conquering king would come back to the capital, riding in his chariot with the conquered nation's king chained to his chariot. He would parade the enemy openly. He would show off the spoils of war, the gold, the silver, all the possessions. The nation would be enriched not only by victory, but because they could share in the spoil. Heirs with God, joint heirs with God. I mean, we are joint heirs. Now just think about that. Conclusion, there's three great questions here that are mentioned. Verse 1, who hath believed our report? Well, I wish this world would believe it. I wish this world would believe it. Who hath believed our report? Also in verse number 1, to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? That's how he brought salvation, is with his arm. I'm glad the night he revealed his arm to me brought salvation. And then verse number 8, who shall declare his generation? We ought to leave this way tonight. I believe it. I've seen it by the grace of God. If you've experienced it, you've seen it. I believe it, I've seen it, and praise God, and I'm going to tell it. How many people are in the Bible, Jesus said, now listen. He even told them demons to shut up. Don't be telling everybody who he is. They couldn't keep their mouth shut. And there were several people that he made whole, and he said, now don't tell anybody, and they had to go tell everybody. When he does something, you just got to tell it. You just got to tell it, amen. Praise the Lord. Amen.